Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome again to this segment of the Oregon Voters Digest. And for those Marines that are out there, simplify. Simplify, Marines. Hey, guess what? The Commandant of the Marine Corps, the U.S. Marine Corps, is in Portland today. Portland, Oregon today. He's visiting with the National Association of Women Marines. Women Marines at the Red Line here in the Portland metropolitan area. Very interesting piece. He's going to be the keynote speaker on Monday evening. And I do plan to be there and probably take some shots. But anyway, I thought I'd throw that out there and give him a shout and say, hey, welcome to Portland, Oregon, the only place where you'll find another Marine. And that's me. But anyway, okay, going jokes aside, again, like I said, I think it would be a nice deal to have him here. And again, General, thanks very much for being in Oregon, and we really appreciate your deal. Hopefully I'll get your comments or whatever. Okay, great. Well, with that, folks, we got quite a show today. I'll tell you, I don't know just how, I've got my guest right here. You've seen both of these guys before. On my right, on your left, you got Bob Williams on the outside there, and you got Richard here.
Hey, Bruce.
Richard, yeah, you know, yeah. And so we're gonna have a good time here, aspect of it. And I guess what we're gonna be doing, I know a lot of us have been spending a lot of our time looking at this whole issue about the conventions, and we've gone through that whole process of the presidential election aspect of it. I mean, we went through the Republican election, we went to the Democrat election, we went to the Libertarian election, we had Green Party, we had all kinds of folks have been talking to Zill. But the two biggest ones were basically Republicans and Democrats. And so this past week, we had the nomination of the Republican Party nominee, and that was Donald Trump. And he's going to be the nominee, and there was all sorts of discussions during this past week. And so what we're going to do in this particular segment, we are going to have that discussion. We're just going to just talk about it. Again, opinions. These are opinions here within our segment, within mm-hmm. our area, here within Oregon aspect of it. And I would suggest that you do the same thing and do the same thing here within your area, wherever you are, okay? And so we're going to do the Republican. And then next week, naturally, the Democrats are going to go through this whole thing. And, you know, hey, watch it. Check it out. And we're going to do the same thing. We're going to have a discussion about the Democratic convention, and that's going to be a great piece aspect of it. And then the third week, we're just going to have a kind of a come-all. It's almost going like an election here locally aspect mm-hmm. of it. We'll probably pay musical chairs and just have people just come up periodically and just talk about what they felt the results.
But no
are.
Throwing chairs.
No throwing chairs.
No.
Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah, just tables.
Okay.
So hey, look. So what we'll do now to start with is that a little background. You know, because I know that. Bob's been around. You've seen him around quite a bit. He's an advocate Democrat. I mean, just no trouble, straight up. But you know, since he's been on the show here, and we've been doing our thing back and forth and whatever. But at the end of the day, he's always about the issues. He fights hard, but all due respect, it is about the issues.
That's it.
That's what it's all about. You know, whether you are or D's or whatever, it's about the issues of how we live here in this country. And Richard Burke, basically the same situation. He's about the issue. I'm very familiar with some of the activities that he's involved in, aspect of it, and that makes for a good dialogue. And that's what we're going to try to do, give you a little insight in terms of trying to define what that convention was all about and what it means to you, the voting part, before you get the voter's pamphlet and before you get that vote by mail piece in the House. You'll know exactly, have some idea what's going down. It's very important, okay? Good. So, guys, let's jump right on and get down to the meat of the matter. In the Republican convention, at the end of the day, businessman Donald Trump was selected the nominee to represent the Republican Party.
Mm-hmm.
And as we know, he is an outsider, and the established, slate, if you will, of all the Republicans that were running, most of these folks came down from the political process.
Mm-hmm.
They were either elected to office in some way, capacity, or whatever. And he's the only one. And the people, it had been said, you know, in terms of polling and this, that, and the other, that the people were tired, if you will, of the established politician, okay? And as a result, the people chose, because really, that's really what they are. They just represented it. And if the people chose, i.e. Donald Trump, that says a lot. And so the idea is that, and I'll just go around the table and ask each of you, what do you think the people were saying when they selected Donald Trump? Bob, start off with you. Why do you think they selected Donald Trump? The people now.
I think that they selected Donald Trump because of the rhetoric that he was able to put out there, and his surrogates were able to quote unquote clarify what he was supposed to be saying when he misspoke.
Okay, so what's the definition of rhetoric? What do you mean?
He would make statements. I'm the law and order candidate, or some of the other statements he made. We're going to build a wall, and Mexico is going to pay for it. Mm-hmm. You know, and then his surrogates would go out, and they would, and someone on the news or somewhere would ask them about that. Well, we don't know if Mexico is going to really pay for it, but we're going to look at how we can build a wall.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, you know, it wasn't so really and truly anything he was saying mm-hmm. that if people knew wasn't going to happen, or don't feel that it's going to happen. Others on the border states, I'm sure they're hoping it happened. Mm-hmm. So he was able to get those border states. But us that live within was listening to him and going, man, this dude is way off his rockers.
Okay, but at the end of the day, he was still selected by a majority.
By a majority of Republicans.
All right. But I'm just saying, he was selected by a majority.
Majority of his party.
Okay, all right, good.
Okay,
good. What do you think, Rich?
I don't think this was a primary campaign about issues. I worked on the Trump campaign for a couple of months during the primary.
Okay.
And what I found is most people, they don't believe the wall is going to be built. They don't really understand how Mexico is going to pay for it. They don't agree with him on a number of things, like when he had earlier talked about banning Muslims from coming to the country. They know that's not going to happen. That's not what people are attracted to.
Okay.
I think most of the Republicans who supported him believe that America is in decline, and that they saw the traditional candidates is not doing anything to reverse that, that they were being trapped into an establishment. They wanted to kick over the chessboard. They were attracted by the idea that Donald Trump might take America out of decline, that America might get its swagger back, that people might, it reminded me a little bit of America in 1980 when we were in the middle of the hostage crisis. Jimmy Carter had the malaise speech, and Ronald Reagan came up and with a very different style from Donald Trump, but Ronald Reagan came and said, hey, look, we're still a great country. You can believe in American exceptionalism. Our best days are not behind us. Mm-hmm. We're going to go forward and we're going to grow. And that's what people responded to, even working class Democrats, blue collar Democrats, and independents. And I think that is the thing that attracted so many Republicans to Donald Trump during the Republican primary process.
Okay. Now, I might add also, too, that when he picked up that majority, if you will, when you start thinking about the majority of the electorate, not the so-called delegate votes aspect of it, many of those folks actually jumped. Some of them were D's, and some of the folks weren't even interested in running for office. I mean, he brought people from the non-participant in the election process and brought them to the table. You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
He brought a lot of those people. What do you think mm-hmm. about that? Why do you?
Well, everybody keeps saying he brought a lot of, he brought D's to it.
D's, R's, none of
there's not a lot. There hasn't been a lot of a shift. There hasn't been a major shift in the Democratic Party regarding Donald Trump. You know, I mean, as far as people deserting the Democratic Party to run to Donald Trump, mm-hmm. that's not happening. But you do realize some
have.
Well, some Republicans have come to the Democratic Party because they hate Donald Trump.
Mm-hmm.
They can't stand him. You know, so, you know, there's going to be a shift in attitude regardless. But the truth of the matter is, people can see through the shiftiness that he did during the convention. The shiftiness, he changes his position every other speech.
But he still got elected.
But no, he still got the votes of the Republican Party.
No. The people. I'm done. It's my understanding. I understand.
He hasn't been elected to anything.
No. My point is that he was selected by the Republican Party.
Okay, I rest my case.
But many of those Republicans were not, they were not listed as Republicans. They came over, if you will.
Mm.
That's how he was able to get the majority. No, he got the majority vote, am I not right?
He got the majority vote, more votes
than any
from
other
Republicans than any other Republican in the past. But what we'll say with due respect to Bob, and I say this not as a Republican. I'm a Libertarian. I'm Secretary of the Oregon Libertarian Party, and so I'm watching the Republican and the Democratic nominating processes through a different eyes, and I notice two things. One is, with respect to your point, there were something like 25,000 Democrats in Massachusetts that changed their registration to vote for Trump. Not a huge number. A big enough number to cock an eyebrow, but but not a huge number. What you're going to find, though, is that Hillary hurt herself with early statements that were regarded to be anti-coal, anti-oil, and a lot of working-class blue-collar Democrats in places like Pennsylvania, Ohio, West Virginia. These are the places where you're going to have people maybe not leave the Democratic Party, but working-class Democrats who are coal miners and oil drillers and those kind of, you know, steel workers. Those are the people that are going to cross the line. And they may not cross the line to Donald Trump. They may go to Gary Johnson. What I think is really interesting
and
about...
who is Gary Johnson?
Gary Johnson is the Libertarian presidential nominee, former two-term governor of New Mexico, and his running mate is Bill Weld, former two-term governor of Massachusetts. Now, if the Republicans and Democrats had nominated two governors, that would be regarded as a respectable ticket. But the Libertarians have done it now, and they're
Still the establishment.
Well, it's an anti-establishment vote. They came from, kind of came from the establishment because they're governors, but they're in a third party, and this is a year where people are looking for alternatives. And what we're finding is when a couple of things when Trump and Hillary are head-to-head, they're very close, or Hillary's a few points behind. When Johnson is included in the poll, it's dead even, or Trump is ahead by a point or two. That indicates that Johnson's pulling a few more votes from Hillary than Trump, if you want to look at it that way, or just earning votes themselves. Right now, Johnson, the Johnson-Weld ticket is about 13%, and in some states, they're in second place. And it is conceivable that Johnson could win a few states, like in Utah right now. He's only 3 points behind Trump, and he's ahead of Hillary. If he wins a few states, he could deny either, he could deny both Trump or Hillary the 270 votes to an electoral college.
These are registered Libertarians.
What chance?
Hold on for a minute.
I'm not talking I'm not talking about registered Libertarians. I'm talking about generally election voters. If Johnson were to win two, three, four states, it could deny both Trump and Hillary the 270 electoral college votes they need to win the election, and the entire race would be thrown out, and it would go to the House of Representatives.
Wow, that's a pretty hit.
That happened one time. I forgot what year it was. In the 1800s, it happened one time, and it's possible that it could happen this year. So this year, it's important to pay attention. And if Johnson gets into the debates, all bets are off, and he's only 2 points below the threshold set up by the committee. And even if he doesn't get into the debates, if he holds at 5%, you know, he'll have the option to accept FEC money, which would be something like $52 million, and that could change the landscape.
Well, 5% of 300 million votes, that's 15 million votes.
And right now he's at 13.
He's at 13.
And so this is a game changer. But coming, rolling back to your original question, people have had it with the establishment. They do feel 70-some percent believe that America is on the wrong track. People do feel they've been managed and cajoled in a direction that they've been talked into going in a place they don't want to go, and they've had it. And so that's why they're not crazy about Hillary. That's why Bernie Sanders had such a good run, even though he's a Democratic Socialist. That's why Trump was able to outlast 17 others. That's why Johnson and Weld are at double digits for the first time ever in our party's history. People have had enough. They want something new.
And as we go through this discussion, and hopefully at the end of the day, whoever the outcome is, that would be basically the direction of this country, bottom line.
Probably,
because when you, again, talking about these, all these other entities that are running, let's get right back to the Trump piece. He talked about the wall deal, and that wall thing was all talk to the whole issue of illegal immigration. Let's talk about that. That's how he got to the wall problem. Right? I guess I think it was at the Nixon administration, Republican Nixon administration, they gave these folks where they registered them, they gave them legal they legalized 11 million. That was under the Nixon administration, right? And then all of a sudden, now all of a sudden today, we're talking about another what? 15, 20
million, yeah.
Not a time they don't even know what the number.
Yeah,
it goes back and forth routine, and so no one made those decisions after that, but now we're stuck with it. And so Donald's position, from the people's standpoint, hey, this is affecting our employment situation, it's affecting this, our lifestyle and whatever. Now all of a sudden the wall comes out. What's your definition of that, Bob? What do you think?
The definition of the wall?
How did it come about?
You're right. He saw something that people on the border states when he was campaigning down there in Arizona and New Mexico and the area, and in those areas where people are just walking across the border, and those border towns were having all kind of unlawful acts taking place there. We'll build a wall. You know, and so when he said it, people bought into it, it resonated with them, and then you have those people inside that says, well, that would be a good idea, that would stop some of these people, but you don't realize how that would affect our economy. Now, let's be real about this.
But not the people.
If you take those illegals out, let's just say we go deport all of them, who's going to do the jobs that they do?
What kind of job? Which job?
Picking
the berries, maybe.
The farms, cotton. You know, they do all of those things. And we in America, remember when we used to go pick berries? We don't do that anymore.
You know, I'm not sure.
We don't have our children doing that. Yeah. And they pay a lot of money into our economy in taxes. Someone needs to look at the overall picture rather than just go, this'll fix it. This is a fix-all. It's not. Okay. There's something that's going to happen on the other side when you start talking and doing things of this nature.
Richard, what do you think about that issue?
Well,
are those the kinds of jobs that Americans will not want to do?
I know that when I was a kid, I detasseled corn, I picked eggs. You know, I actually worked in the fields myself growing up in Nebraska. It was a summer job for a lot of kids that were 12, 13 years old. Mm-hmm. The states have outlawed kids of those age working, and that is part of what's created.
Through the legislature.
Part of what created the vacuum. Now, I think that Bob has a point. We've become dependent on illegal immigrant labor. But a lot of folks say that securing our border would be a racist act. I can see a side of that, and we need to be conscious of that. But there are legitimate issues. One of the legitimate issues I see is the situation with respect to Mexico itself. In my opinion, Mexico has no excuse to be poor. It has agriculture, rare minerals, access to both oceans for shipping, access to the North American market, access to the South American market. It has oil, it has agriculture, it has everything a country needs. Mexico should be one of the most wealthy nations on the face of the earth. And because they are so corrupt and so badly run, it has created a situation where people want to escape it. That represents a threat to the United States, an unstable neighbor to the South. It is the cause of a lot of the illegal immigration. And I think the long-term answer to this problem is to work with Mexico to make Mexico better, to make Mexico less corrupt, to make it more prosperous. There are a lot of levers that the United States has to try and influence them, economic, diplomatic, political, all of these things. And I think we should try to work with Mexico using some of those levers to make Mexico better. Then, if things get too bad in the United States, we might have Mexico Americans going down there.
Okay.
I'll tell you what, the Mexican laws for illegal immigration are draconian compared to ours. You're an American illegally goes down to Mexico, you are in prison for a long, long time. I think that these libertarians support open borders, but we also do not support a welfare state. And myself and many libertarians I know say open borders fine if they don't have access to the welfare state.
Can I ask you a question
here?
If you support open borders, how do you control it? I mean, an open border means anyone can come at any time.
Yeah.
And I'm not for that, and I'm a Democrat.
Right.
You know, I believe that we have laws in place that says if you want to come here, there's a certain procedure you take to get here.
Mm-hmm.
It's protection of the people that are here. Therefore, if you circumvent that, you're illegal. That's what the illegal part means. And therefore, if they're going to use the illegal portion of it, then they're supposed to deport those people. Plain and simple. But we have allowed this to take place for so long until mm-hmm. now we can't do those. We can't do what our laws require us to do.
Well, sure.
And Donald Trump is not the answer.
No, but he hit your point. He said, hey, I'm putting a wall. And all of a sudden, people rallied to the deal.
Yeah.
So what's the other option?
So the other option is from this day forward, you know, if you come to this country, you better come collect, correct.
What are you going to do if they still come?
If they still come, then you deport them.
But he's tried that. I mean, what's that?
No, we don't deport anyone.
No, the establishment don't even.
The only reason we deport someone is because they do something wrong.
I want to clarify. I want to clarify something. When I say open borders, I don't mean no border controls.
Okay.
What I mean is, you can go back and forth. It's easier to go back and forth. Like, for example, it doesn't require a visa to go to Ukraine because of an arrangement between the United States and Ukraine. I argue they have open borders. I still have to go through customs,
mm-hmm.
you know, and they still make sure I don't have illegal contraband and all these other sorts of things. And they still check if I'm a criminal. But otherwise, I can go back and forth.
Are you
Ukrainian? No, I'm not Ukrainian. Well, but I play one on TV.
You had that smile.
Yeah.
That's right.
You stayed at a Holiday Inn.
That's right.
Check you out here.
But I do think that because we do have a welfare state,
okay.
and because Mexico is so dysfunctional, I think we do have to have border controls.
Okay.
Now, the wall, we don't know anything about this wall idea, really.
Okay,
it's a concept, and I think that we could probably have strong border controls, you know, without necessarily a great wall.
Well, let me ask you two guys. I'm going to throw something out back here. I'm getting again from Trump. We're talking about the Trump situation.
Right.
When I got out of the conversation in terms of his rationale for doing that, and then the idea was from a solution aspect of it, just on another side, as I looked at this piece, let's say they're picking berries at $10 an hour, and all of a sudden they increase it to $15. You think people would want those jobs?
Some people might.
Those are livable wage jobs, right? What if I raise it up to $20 an hour?
Then yeah.
But solve the problem.
Who's going to buy the berries?
Food prices.
You will, because you want those berries and then deal with your peanut butter.
Then they go out. See, but that's what I'm talking about.
No. Let me address $20 an hour for berries.
Okay.
An hour. You saying people aren't going to want those jobs?
I'm an ex-union rep. Pay them.
Well, I know you got unionized a job. I know that.
But here's the thing. There's when you raise the price of berries,
yes.
you better be raising salaries other places so they can afford to buy berries.
Wait a minute, Bob. That's not what I asked you. I said if you just raise it $15 an hour. I'm talking about those folks who don't. I'm talking about those Americans who mm-hmm. don't want, if you will, mm-hmm. to do those jobs. And there are folks who want to work.
Right.
Because before we got into this business of i.e. Americans don't want to do the job, how would the berries pick then?
Or I think you repeal the laws that prevent kids from working in the field.
See, and we had
migrant, not little kids,
we had
not
migrant
the slaves,
workers
but,
that went from camp to camp
right,
to camp
right.
to camp.
They had a system, right?
Right.
They had a system.
Right.
Then guess what? In all due respect, the farmers got greedy.
That's right.
And then guess what? The kids were picking the berries with no problem. Families were picking the berries, buying their clothes, and this, that, and the other. And then someone got a bright idea in the legislature to say, gee whiz, that was lobbied, if you will, by the farmers, and say, hey, we want more money,
mm-hmm.
right?
Right.
And we're going to, i.e., expand this program that you talked about, the migrant workers,
mm-hmm.
right? And bring them over and pay them even less. They're just opening the borders to them now, right?
Right.
That's the mess we got in.
That's right.
Fair? Mm-hmm.
Right.
Is that fair? Well, Donald Trump said, hey, it affects our economy.
How?
Well, the bottom line is Americans, Americans want to work. They want to pick those berries up.
No, he didn't say nothing about picking no berries.
What about the highway system, the highway department?
Okay. Well,
a lot of illegals have been working on highway work. We know that.
They've been doing a lot of other things. Look at your homes.
Well, I'm just saying. but my point is that we talk about the Trump thing. Well, again, this is what I heard. The guy was saying, in fact, he even made a point about the fact that many blacks were losing their jobs as a result of the illegals. You remember that?
Yeah.
Okay, so he was saying, hey, if I'm getting elected, that's not going to happen here. He threw that out on the table. And I'm throwing that out to you guys, both of you.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do? Is that something? Is that a problem with that? That's for building the wall. He said, hey, I'm going to build the wall because Americans are losing their jobs.
Well, I don't think that illegal aliens are, I shouldn't call that, migrant workers are taking jobs away from Americans that want to work in the fields.
And wait a minute, that's not migrant. We're talking about the folks who are undocumented. You can use
Undocumented workers
are taking
jobs away from people that want to work in the field.
Right. Okay.
Okay. They are doing a job that the farmers can't get enough people that want to do that job. That's where they come in. And the farmers realized it, so they wanted a way to bring people over from other countries that were suffering with a lack of economy to do the work, that would do this work. And so poor Latinos from different countries came here with the idea that they could do that work, send money back, and eventually become a citizen here.
And then we get more Americans on welfare.
Well,
because
that's a totally different story.
No,
it's
Americans
on
welfare.
See, my point is this. Now, again, I'm not trying to. I say I'm Trump. We're talking about Trump. I'm hearing about the rationality he was giving because we've been bothered about that.
Let's look at this. Let's say that we are in a world where Mexico repairs itself. The GNP of Mexico doubles. There are lots of jobs in Mexico, and the Mexicans who are looking for prosperity. They go, why should I be here illegally if I can be there legally and make money? So they all leave, okay? Let's say that they leave to go back to a prosperous Mexico. Would the crops just rot in the field? I don't think they would. I think that what would happen is there would be innovations in automated agriculture, like there have been with things like, you know, combines, cotton gins. So they'd invent new technologies to automate it, which would solve part of the problem. Some people would be probably higher wages that would attract some people. I think we'd see a repeal of laws that prevent 13, 14, 15-year-olds from working in the fields. I remember we used to get on a bus with, you know, tons of kids, and we'd go out and detassel corn for, you know, $5. We'd have a little pocket money. We'd learn a work ethic. We got up and went to work. And but now that's all illegal. I think that would be
changed.
What's
illegal? Well, for kids to work? No, that's not illegal.
If you are 14 years old and you want
to
work,
you have to have a parent. Your parents have to approve you working, and there's certain things that you can do.
That's state by state. And
well,
some states,
that's not a blanket thing.
Yeah.
But that's the way the law is written.
But see, they could change that. So right now, like in Iowa, you can't get a work permit until you're 16. You need parental consent for that. So 14, 15, 13-year-olds, they can't work.
Yeah, no, and that's not true in Iowa, because in Iowa, 14, 15-year-olds can work if they're working on their parents' farm.
Well, on their parents' farm. Well, my parents didn't have a farm. I had to work on somebody else's farm. And that was the case with most of the kids that were working with me.
Yeah.
Well, we we're spending quite a bit of time here. Yeah. Looks like you're getting ready to have another convention.
Hey, no, we're not.
That's right.
Okay, I didn't try to go, and I've been to five.
Still, we're still talking about the convention, and we're talking about Trump. The other point he made was about trade.
Oh.
About trade. And both of the major parties basically supported the idea of importing the trade. And I'm using New Mexico. Mm-hmm. A lot of the businesses, blue-collar and white-collar jobs, were basically going to, let's say, in Mexico, for that matter. I mean, you know, some of the automakers, right, the parts and things of that nature, a lot of people lost their jobs as a result of it. He is saying, I'm going to bring those jobs back.
How?
The way he said, well, guess what? I'm going to tariff them big time. So now it's not a benefit. As much of a benefit to an employer.
It was a Republican bill that passed the House and Senate that said, if you have your office here, you can have your manufacturing elsewhere, and we won't charge you a tariff.
I'm agreeing with you. That's
so I want to see him get something through the House and the Senate to take that back.
If he gets
that ain't gonna happen.
If he gets elected, he'll probably have what he thinks is a mandate, and I think a substantial number of congressmen and women will go along with it because they'll see the handwriting on the wall.
Well, the handwriting on the wall.
I'm going to call that crap.
No,
because these guys have two things on their mind. One, keeping their job, and two, keeping their business constituency happy. That's what your Congress do. They keep their job and they keep their business constituency happy, and that way they maintain their job.
All right, and Bob. You're a good point. We're going to take a short break, but I think it's still a government of the people, by the people,
no,
for the people. And they do vote.
That's in writing.
I mean? And that's how they get there. He said he's going to get them out of there. All right, we're going to take a short break and we get right back on Bob.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
Again to the Republican convention, folks. Boy, we got it going right now. People on the floors are yelling. They're making statements. New York made this statement, and Bob in Oregon made another statement. Richard came up with another statement. He's Ukrainian, so he just got here, and he's trying to get
Irish-Ukrainian, right?
Oh, Irish-Ukrainian. Right. Okay, so we really got it going here, folks. I think the last thing we talked about was the fact that the people don't vote anymore. It's not a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. And that means that the Congress elect themselves. And then Donald he jumped in there and he got rid of all of them because he got the vote.
Well, that's what he said he was going to do, get them out. I want to see it. You know.
Well, that's the convention, though. I mean, my point, he was appointed. We're waiting for the second person to get appointed, and then we're going to elect someone.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, we're going to have whoever comes up, I take it. You will support that person, whoever that person is, whether it be Hillary or Donald.
What?
Oh, there it goes again. All right, again. You know, it's an equal deal, right?
No.
Majority wins.
It's nothing equal.
Nothing equal?
Majority wins? That's not necessarily
true. Majority don't win anymore?
No, because I remember somebody ran against Bush and... he had the majority. He didn't win.
Yeah, there have been three or four minority presidents who won the Electoral College.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
One under the bridge now. We're talking about this convention right now.
Okay.
Have spoken. They said, look, we run this country.
Yeah.
A government of
what
the people,
what people,
by
folk?
People. Huh?
What people?
The ones who get the voting ballots. The ballots. The one who has the ballots, you know, and they put a little X behind.
So you're telling me 25% of the people in this country determines what's going on, because that's what you get.
I didn't say 25%.
But that's what vote.
I think it's well, the percentage of people who are is higher than that. But what I will say,
where
In the United States, like in Oregon,
we're not in Oregon, see?
Yeah,
no, but in the United States, they work on 25% of the vote.
Well, okay. What I will tell you,
that, and right now, Trump has 24 of them.
No, 24 of the people.
Listen, the average American spends about 5 minutes a week thinking about politics.
That's right.
We're political animals.
That's right.
And that's because what we have lost a civic culture. You know, most high schools in the country now, and almost none in Oregon, teach civics.
That's right. That's right.
Anymore.
That's right.
If we are literally getting the government we deserve because we are disengaged. And if you know, who was it that said the victory goes to the person that shows up, right? If the special interests are the ones running the country, it is only because we have ceded that power. Mm-hmm. We have to take responsibility for our own governance. That's the entire concept behind the United States.
Mm-hmm.
And if we do not take up our self-governance, then this is what's going to happen. I think we need to do everything we can to get people engaged. Now, one thing is with the Bernie Sanders campaign and the Donald Trump campaign, and to a slightly lesser degree, the Gary Johnson campaign, people have started to pay attention.
Yeah.
And where that will take us, you know, anybody's guess at this point. But if a small collection of interests is running this country, it is only because we have ceded power as individuals.
Well, okay. I can't agree with you more on that.
Yeah.
But this didn't happen in the last 8 years, 12 years, 20 years, 24 years. This happened early in the 1900s.
Yes.
I mean, we began to relinquish the power and say, hey, I voted for you. You need to do for me. And then we began to not demand anything from our elected officials. They were there and they began to make their own decisions on what they would do because they needed the money to run for the next time.
Well, and part of
and
that.
So we began to look at people in political office and go, when there's a problem, we wanted instant gratification, but there was no long-term gain.
Let's say, though, that
let's
say, for example, I mean, in a hypothetical world, that there was no corporate welfare in this country. That
what's
mechanisms
the
didn't
What's the definition of corporate welfare?
I would say corporate welfare is when government subsidizes a business in a manner that falls outside of a business reacting to market forces.
Okay.
Okay. That's what I would call. But let's say it didn't exist. If it didn't exist and there was no largesse to give away, they wouldn't give big campaign contributions because there'd be nothing to buy, right? Of course, we know there is. But I mean, check out your interest groups. Any interest group that you have, public school teachers, Halliburton, whatever they are. The reason why they donate money is because government has gotten so big, it's got tons of goodies to give away. If we really want corruption out of government, we reduce the size so it has fewer goodies to give away. Fewer goodies to give away are going to attract fewer corrupting contributions of the kind he's talking about.
Okay. Let's get into another issue. We got to get another issue. Now, let's get back to the person who's running. Again, we're talking about Trump.
Mm-hmm.
His definition. He's a businessman.
Right.
He's a builder. Right?
Okay.
He's a builder. Okay, and he's married. He's got a family. Right?
Mm-hmm.
He cares for his family. You saw it. I mean, there he was. The kids have gone to school. They're bright kids and whatever. He's also incorporated them in his business, right?
Mm-hmm.
And at the other side of the coin, he was calling all the shots. Because as a builder and developer, there can only one CEO.
Right.
Right? Right? And so when you think about this country, when you're making decisions... You basically, it's the same deal. I'm talking about, you can give your definition of what he looked. This is what I saw. I saw a guy who was a businessman, he was a builder, and he built this company. However you want to say it, you know, they're arguing about the taxes and this, that, and the other, but you know, he's going through hoil like anything else. But the bottom line is that in you building, because I was in the same boat, I built a senior citizen complex myself. I had to call the shot, and I was responsible for everything.
Well, you know, Americans...
No, this is what I'm saying. So my point is that that, to me, is what I think a lot of people saw. The fact, and all the goodies that he had, you know, from the standpoint of planes and this, that, and the other, that was wealth. It was kind of a sign of achievement of some sort. So that's one definition. The other definition that I saw in this particular guy is that he was running it just like a business. Mm-hmm. And people, in all due respect, it resonated from the standpoint of change. People wanted change, because like you were saying, people just got tired of this congressional stuff. I mean, the lobbyists were there, they were representing the corporation, and we had no access, and they pretty well controlled the media, total media aspect of it. And so the last time, basically, when they do get to the public as a whole, is that last minute when you get those flyers in the mail, or you see the electorate sitting up there kissing babies or something like that, or somebody supported this, that, and the other, and I don't even know who the person is. So my point is that this guy, that's who he is. And then when you look at the other candidate on the established side, the person has never accomplished anything.
Right.
They're articulate, they got a political background. I'm just throwing that out there. Now, what's your difference? I'm gonna ask each one of you guys, how did you see Trump from that individual standpoint? The family, the business, and how do you see it? How did you see him?
I saw him as his kids came forward and said that he was a good dad. You know,
is that okay?
That's great. But what does that do for me? I saw him come forward that he's a good business, that he runs his business. They didn't talk about the ones he lost. They talk about the ones that he had.
But in business,
so
that's what
wait a minute.
Hold on, you
got to give me mine.
I'm gonna give you your mind.
Okay. And so, you know, if you're gonna tell me all the positive, and that's because you want something from me. You don't talk about your negatives. And so that's one thing. But America is not a business. Okay. It has a lot of moving parts and a lot of people that think that they have a vote. So that they can be heard. and you, the if you're the owner of the business, you don't have to depend on, don't have to listen to anyone else. You make the decision. You know, they are your hired help. We're not no one's hired help. And that's the way he makes me feel, that he's a businessman and we're the hired help, and he's going to tell us what he wants and when we can do it and what we should do.
Okay, so, so what's your definition of what we have now?
What we have now? What we have now is a locked up Congress and a president that's trying to make some moves that can't.
And that's it's not working, right? Now you agree.
It's not working because they are not, we elected these people to work to work out their differences and work together.
And they're not doing it.
And they're not doing it.
So we need change.
So the change, but the change isn't the Donald Trump.
So who is it? Who is it? Who should it be?
It's someone that can make, that can get both sides to come together and begin to
and
work.
How do you
for
how
us.
Do you get that person?
How do you get it? You use your vote and you determine who you think that person should be.
Well, didn't we go through a process?
We didn't go through a process yet.
What do you mean?
The process will take place in November.
Well, I understand that, but you got, okay. We got two major parties.
We got two major parties.
But you got one that made a selection on one.
One that's made a selection.
Regardless of how you, whatever you like, there's a majority.
But I didn't make that selection.
I know you didn't.
Okay. And a lot, and there's over 300 million people in this country that didn't make that selection.
No, that's 14 that's in November. Million. That's in November.
Oh, now all of a sudden you go talk about November, but you go tell me that somebody made the selection.
No, we're talking about Trump. We're not talking about Hillary right now. That might
I'm saying that 14 million people on this last week made a determination for them.
For that piece.
Let's see what happens next week.
Right. Could be. In fact, I heard the other day that they were looking at, what's my man's name again? Bernie again. They think about Bernie.
That was a Republican. That's the Republican saying they should. Yeah. When your enemy can tell your troops what they should be thinking,
what's the enemy?
Something is wrong.
Who's the enemy?
Trump.
How's he going to be the enemy? I told you before when we closed, a government of the people, by the people.
But he's not government nothing.
I understand what he's saying.
You know, jeez, would you mind defining an let me know, because I'm over here.
I
think what he's saying is, correct me if I'm wrong, Democrats.
Don't look at him.
Democrats are not Republicans. Trump's the Republicans, who is the, quote, enemy, right? And that if they're accepting, I think what he's saying is if they're accepting advice from someone who is the enemy, then something is wrong. Is that right?
That's it.
Okay. Well,
I'm running against you, but, and he's part of your team. And I go, you know, Bruce is not a good guy. He did this, he did that. And they should be invested. They should be investigating him for this.
Yeah. But you know something?
You know, and there's maybe it's 20 of them over there.
Okay.
And I can get two of them to say,
But he voted for me.
But devil's advocate.
Well, that's what I hope.
What's the saying? Even a blind squirrel finds a nut once in a while.
Yeah.
You know, I listen to what you have to say, and if, you know, there are
people that... I should be smart enough to determine whether or not what you're saying is true.
Right.
And the American people are not acting smart sometimes, because they will not go out and research for the truth. They just listen to you and believe.
Whoever
say it the best.
But check this out. That's why we go through this process of conventions. That's when you're presenting the facts, people are hearing.
No, you're presenting your side of the facts.
No, listen to what
I'm
saying.
That's a totally different thing than your side.
There's a third side of this too.
Yeah.
If I'm
still watching TV. I'm looking at the TV stuff. I'm looking at the convention.
Now, first of all, I've got to make a plug in. You said there are two major parties. That's true. The Libertarian Party, however, could have a major impact.
Yeah, they're a minority
race.
Party.
Yeah, but they could have a major impact on this race, and then they won't be so minor.
But right now, they're not.
But I'll set that on the shelf for a moment.
Trump, right now.
Right now,
give me your definition of Trump.
This is what I think about Trump.
Give me about his family.
I will.
Go through the process.
I will. Okay, now there are people who vote on issues and ideology. But I think most of the electoral mainstream, what they see when they look at Trump is they see somebody who is a winner, they see somebody who is successful, and they see somebody who has glamour. Now, Democrats have fallen to this too. Michelle and President Obama have a certain glamour that was very attractive to voters. John F. Kennedy and Jackie Kennedy has a certain glamour that was attractive to voters. Melania Trump and Donald Trump are and their family are going to benefit from that phenomenon. It's not ideological, it's not issue-based, but it's going to be impactful. Also, Donald Trump, he's had some bankruptcies, sure. A lot of people in business have, but he is undeniably successful. Americans, there's still something in the American character that loves a winner. That loves a winner, that loves somebody that's successful. And that's going to be something that's going to be very difficult for Hillary Clinton to compete
Why?
With.
Why? She was a farm girl.
Wait a minute.
She was a farm girl that's now a millionaire, Bob, and y'all want to talk about her being a millionaire?
Bob, I told you, you'll have your
time. I'm sorry.
You know, but,
yeah, be sorry.
But that's but what we, Republicans
no,
do.
Talking, now, Gary
Bob,
Johnson,
I told
rhetoric.
You this is about Trump.
Yeah, but yeah. They no, shoot no. the rhetoric
they
out there,
been,
and it's not true. Somebody
Bob,
have to call them on.
Bob, we know
now,
you're
the people,
a Democrat.
Okay, I'll come.
We know you're a Democrat.
No, the people.
And you with Hillary. We haven't talked about the letters,
folks,
you know,
folks,
and all that stuff
like,
yet.
The folks like Bob here, who are motivated by issues and maybe ideologies more than the mainstream voter.
Right.
It, are going to take the position that Bob's taken. Okay. And it's not wrong. It's not a wrong position. It's just that the mainstream is going to respond to these other forces too. Now, the coal miners in Pennsylvania, they're going to vote their interests. And so are the steel workers, you know, in Ohio. But there are a lot of people that are going to vote on these intangible, emotional issues. And Donald Trump has that. Gary Johnson does too, but it's harder to project out into the mainstream. Hillary has a harder time. She's come up largely on the coattails of her husband. She's worked hard and she's accomplished some things, but
well, now stick with Trump now.
It's not the same kind of thing as Trump. It's not the same dynamic
but
as Trump.
But he talked about that.
He did talk about
that. Okay.
I mean,
that's
if
fair.
You
that's
know,
fair.
Yeah, and I'm not saying that to disparage Hillary because she's had a lot of great accomplishments in her life, but I think this is the
but
emotional response.
But that's politics.
A lot of mainstream voters
that's a
are going to have.
Slam.
Okay, now, hey, Bob, I know you wanted to relate to one point. This coal issue, because he brought this coal issue up. Donald Trump did. He brought the coal issue up.
But Hillary brought it up.
I know, but
she said,
Hillary
I put you
brought
out of
it
business.
Up, she's going to put them out of it. They said that. I mean, she said that. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
And then she went back to try to apologize and turn it around. Remember that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but that was done.
Trump,
no, but politics is politics.
Right.
And he uses that, and he used that this time around to get the majority vote, you know, i.e. to set the platform.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we just went through that process. He's using that. Fair? Mm-hmm. Got me? And in that, he's using the same. He used a whole bunch of stuff about the what do you call it? The computer stuff. What's the deal with the they've been using the in this whole issue of security and stuff.
Oh yeah,
encryption.
The mail.
Hacking. China hacking into our computer systems and things of this nature. He talked about lesbians and gays. He talked
no,
about.
No, but I'm just saying.
Yeah,
he used various issues. But again, in all due respect. A lot of that stuff was from a factual standpoint, from his standpoint, for his platform.
Okay.
So the idea is that's the platform that I understand he's going to be going with. He got a listed platform.
This week.
And then Hillary's got her platform, but we're talking about Trump right now.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So the bottom line
is largely irrelevant to
right.
the candidates.
Right. Right. That's all it is. And then you got the media that's analyzing all this stuff. Then this day, at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm.
He's already selected. Ready to go. Now, we're going through the process now. We're going to go through that situation. Now, the Democrats are going through that process of debating and this, that, and the other. At the end of the day, there will be a platform that she will develop. Pro or not. And then the R people are going to basically be basically the same thing like you are, saying, well, they know she didn't know what she knows she was doing. She's lying and this, that, and the other. But my point is that whatever we think, she has to go with her best shot. He's going with his best shot. And as you say, in November, we'll know. Then the people
will make the determination.
Yeah, the people will make the, again, it's the government of the people, by the people, for the people. And the rationale is still the same. People are just upset with the establishment. She happens to be an establishment, but Donald is not part of the establishment's feed. But still, if at the end of the day she wins, then guess what? People say, well, majority won. I guess I'm just
no, they're not going to do that. They're going to do what they did when President Obama won. They'll go to their corner and they are locked up. They'll lock things up and they'll try and lock. They'll lock people out.
We agree with that.
You know,
but I'm saying,
and that's
Bob,
what I'm talking about.
What are you talking about?
It's not the president that make all of the decisions.
Yeah.
You got to get your Congress in order.
But don't kid yourself. If Donald Trump wins the election, the Democratic caucus is going to filibuster.
I would.
Yeah, well, that, you know, so that's not a side that either major party can take moral high ground on.
Well, when I'm in charge, you're going to mm-hmm. work against me. Now, when you're in charge, what am I supposed to do? No, it ain't going to work that way. And that's what we, the people, have to get them to stop.
But Bob,
Bob's right about that.
I agree with that part of it. But again, that's really what this campaign's about. That's what's so serious about it. We don't have it. They're saying they're tired of exactly what you're saying. And people are coming out of the cracks and saying, I'm going to vote this time around.
But it wasn't involved. The presidency that did that was doing it. Mm-hmm. What the president did, let's talk about the president of today.
I want to go back with Trump.
Okay.
We can't talk about
Trump because he's a businessman and he's been running business. I don't want a businessman trying to run my government. Well, that's a totally different thing.
But I don't want a government agent trying to run my business either.
They
do it all the time. Through regulations and
well, regulations are there to protect the people.
Wait a minute. Look what
happened in Southeast Portland. Yeah. In Southeast Portland, with lack of regulation.
I'm talking about
the glass company over there that's spewing out all these toxic waste.
Well, don't forget that regulations are often used by big business in coordination with government to prevent competition. You know, like the here in Portland, the pack and load industry.
Yeah, I got five.
Company's got a bunch of laws passed.
I hate to cut you guys off, but I got five minutes.
Sure.
I got five minutes. I got to get on Trump. Now we got five minutes.
Let's go. Let's go.
Now we got 5 minutes. Here's the deal. You're going to vote for Trump. I know that. I can see right now.
You sure?
For what you've been, your conversation, you're going to vote. Because all the issues that you're talking about, that's your solution. And then I think that, Rich, you got another entity that I think you might be interested in. You're going to try to put a little bit more pressure in this next race aspect of it. There's a possibility you might just tear up this whole
thing. You and Bruce.
There you go. I know. Hey, I tell you what, there'll be a chicken.
You got what you want.
There'll be a chicken in every pot. Trust me.
Okay.
Right off the bat. No problem. You'd mind, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
You'd vote for me, would you?
I'd vote for you.
All right, then. So, hey, that's it, folks. That's it. We may close the show now on that note because I will never get that note again. But anyway, the bottom line is that, again, for the benefit of the viewing public, this is what you need to do. Just sit around the table and kind of get a sense of what's going on. I would strictly advise you to really look at those conventions. In fact, they're going to do some reruns, I'm sure, on the Republican deal. Hey, look at them. I don't give a damn if you're Republican, Democrat, Independent, Green Party, whatever. I mean, it's an educational piece in itself because they're throwing things on the table because you got a pro and a con.
And this is a very rare year when both, or I should say all three, but both major party conventions are actually interesting.
Yes.
And they don't know all of the outcomes.
Yes, yes.
They don't know what it's going to happen. Like this whole Debbie Wasserman Schultz thing and the Ted Cruz thing.
Oh, it's going to be
an interesting year.
It's good stuff.
And there was some wacky stuff that happened at the Libertarian convention, too.
Good. Look, we got about 4 minutes, and I thought maybe we'd do a couple of things about our own state. We've got two people running, and that's going to be an interesting convention aspect of it, too. We got Bud Pierce on the Republican ticket side, and then we've got Kate Brown, who's the incumbent governor, and that's going to be a very interesting piece on the Democratic side aspect of it. I mean, we want to be more debates. I think that's going to be resolved. Is she going to now debate Bud Pierce? Mm-hmm. Are they going to have debates now? We need to have those discussions. That's what I'm saying.
And it'll be interesting to see if there are third party candidates in those
third party. Okay, good. So my point is that's what's happening right now. And if you want to put a little bit more pressure on both sides of the deal aspect of it, we need more debates.
We do.
We do need them, and more public debates as far as I'm concerned.
And we invite them here?
Bob, will you take the opportunity to have Kate come on down here?
And you'll do Bud?
No, I already did it.
No, you did?
Oh, yeah, he's already been interviewed. He's ready to go. Mm-hmm. And then we just need to get her up there to talk about her platform. And then after that happened, Bud said, okay, we'll have a debate between the two of them.
Well,
but
that'll be on them.
That'll be on them on the debate between the two of them. They represent the people. No, we.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, she got to represent me.
Tell the people to send them letters telling them that they should debate.
That's what you're going to do.
Let's get the people involved in this.
That's
Bruce, it's not a Bob. It's
we the people.
The Oregon Voters Digest is the people, Bob.
That's right.
That's why we're doing what we're doing. Can you contact her, please?
I will definitely.
And tell her to get over here.
I think she's being contacted as we speak.
Are you? Kate, you heard that. I didn't do that. I'm just the moderator aspect.
I know her.
These guys, you know her. Yeah. He knows you personally, Kate. I know she's from Portland.
Yes.
And Kate's a good person. I remember I was a Buffalo soldier, and I was, in fact, I was in the Hollywood deal and whatever, and I was kind of poppies and whatever, and then I saw her and we didn't get, so it was good.
Oh yeah.
But the bottom line is that that's what it's all about.
She's been doing good things for him.
Good. Well, bring her here.
Yeah.
Okay. Good deal. That sounds good. Now, let's see, anything else we got going as far as the state that's very exciting? Well, we got the police thing. I think from our local standpoint here in Northeast Portland, again, that's another major issue. Teresa
School.
Is out there doing her thing with reference to Black Lives Matters, and then we got the police department.
Yeah.
I would hope very much so. We'd like to have them come together. We'd like to get them together. We got Daryl Turner, who happens to be an African American, and he also is the president of the police union, and we got Teresa, who's got Black Lives Matter aspect of it, and 80% of those folks are white, so I mean, evidently they must be caring about some of the issues that blacks are having here within the Portland metro area. So in all due respect, we need to have two of those individuals, both of those.
Yeah.
I'll contact Daryl, you contact Teresa.
That sounds like a and have them. Let me write that down.
Please write that down. I mean, please write that down. And make sure you put your name behind Teresa, okay? And I got Daryl.
Okay,
good. That sounds good. You got anything you want to throw to the table?
We're still nominating candidates for the November election. We'll be having a candidate nominating convention on August 7th.
What kind of candidate? What kind of offices you
for state legislature and all these other things? The
governor and all that other stuff.
The nominating process is in dispute within our party, but we will be holding we're going to try to solve it. We're going to hold the candidate nominating convention on August 7th. People can go to lporegon.net.
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 Okay, real quick.
And as you notice, the school the superintendent, she resigned after our show.
That's right. And I saw you yelling at her.
I didn't yell at her because
and said that she should be fired.
I said she's not the cause of the problems in that school. And when I did some research, and one day we're going to talk about that on this show.
That's right. But she got fired. She left.
She left. She didn't get fired. Yeah. She quit and took her big money salary.
Good. Yeah. Well, I saw some guy.
She sure did, didn't she?
I saw some guy.
That was a
I saw
wow,
somewhere
I
said you
got to
quit or something like that. But anyway, we got 10 more seconds. Hey, folks, thanks for being with us. I hope you enjoyed the show. Please do one on your own, okay? And vote this time around. Vote. Have a good one. Take care. See you later.